ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure and honor for me to chair this session. My name is Athanassios Kaissis. I'm a professor of law in the law school in Aristotle's University, Thessaloniki, and member of the governing board in International Hellenic University, where I am the scientific director of three postgraduate courses. The first of them is an LLM in transnational commercial law, European commercial law, and alternative dispute resolution. The second one is energy law, and the third one is art, law, and economy. I am former president of the EPA Thessaloniki. I would like to thank very much the organizers, and especially Professor Metaxas, for this invitation. Our first speaker, Mr. Theoharis, is coming. So we will begin with the presentation of Mr. Paidakakis. Mr. Paidakakis is a legal officer in a regulatory authority for energy, in the well-known RAE. A well-known lawyer with a profound knowledge of competition and energy law. He worked in many prestigious law firms, and he will briefly analyze the legal debate about Nord Stream 2, focusing on the legal and regulatory risks of connecting pipelines. I invite to the podium Mr. Paidakakis. Please, you have the floor.
Thank you, Professor Kaissis, for the kind introduction. I would also like to thank the organizers for the invitation. Later on, apparently, Mr. Theoharis will give an overview of the very exciting developments that are currently taking place upstream. Even more so in our region, in our neighborhood. Should these attempts materialize, Europe will add another major source of gas. This is very important given the fact that our indigenous production is going down really fast. But transmission of natural gas in particular has been traditionally another issue. On the one hand, it's necessary. On the other hand, it's a very expensive business and highly dependent on geopolitics. Just imagine in the early days of drilling, when people were coming across a natural gas well instead of an oil one, they would rather close it down and move on. Of course, this is not the case anymore. And before I move on, I would like to just highlight another issue, that there is no such a thing as a peace pipeline. You'll see later, Mr. Theoharis will touch upon these issues. There is no such a thing as peace pipeline. First, you make peace, and then you build the pipeline. So on top of these constraints I've just mentioned, you add the regulatory framework. And when you target Europe, the security of supply element comes in the forefront. So what I will try to do within the next 10 minutes is first to present to you briefly the legal debate about the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. Right after, I will try to explain to you the ambiguities about connecting pipelines, meaning the onshore extension of import pipelines, and focus in particular on the security of supply test included in the relevant provisions of the third energy package. In this context, I will spend a few minutes taking you through the decisional practice of the European Commission in four major cases, two of them concerning the Article 36 exemption, and the other two, the Article 11 of the gas directive certification process, which is also known as the gas from clause. Hopefully, by the end of it, some takeaway points will have emerged, and with that, I will close my presentation. Okay, so first comes first. This is Nord Stream 2. It's a pipeline that is planned to cross the Baltic Sea from Russia to Germany. It's running parallel with already existing Nord Stream 1. Most importantly, it's the latest addition to Gazprom's transit diversification strategy. In short, Gazprom's strategy is to terminate the Ukrainian route altogether after 2019, if possible. In order to do that, Russia had originally planned the construction of the now known as Nord Stream 1 and South Stream. But after the cancellation of the latter, Russia activated Nord Stream 2 as a viable alternative. Of course, Russia still faces several constraints: political, with the annexation of Crimea, commercial, low oil prices and sanctions, and regulatory. And by regulatory, I mean the application of the third energy package on Nord Stream 2, which has proven to be a highly debatable issue. So, does the EU energy legislation apply on a pipeline project such as Nord Stream 2? For those who very actively claim that this is the case, the main argument is that the pipeline, and to be exact, 100 kilometers of it, would go through the territorial waters of both Denmark and Germany. Plus, it would go through the exclusive economic zone of 8 member states in total. So they claim that this is more than enough for the third energy package to apply to Nord Stream 2. But they also add that Nord Stream 2 contradicts the objectives of the EU's energy union, meaning energy security, solidarity and trust, and a move away from fossil fuels. Finally, they also wonder how on earth, they say, how on earth Nord Stream 2 can be built under the current situation with the annexation of Crimea. Of course, there is a rebuttal to all that. Nord Stream 2, its supporters say, is an import pipeline where the laws of the sea apply instead. Plus, the third energy package is not applied on Nord Stream 1, nor on the pipelines in the Mediterranean Sea. Other than that, this is just an attempt to politicize the application of EU energy legislation, bending the rules to an unacceptable level or even to a breaking point. If you ask me, and before we move on to the next part of the presentation, in this particular case, the jurisdiction of the coastal member states and therefore of the EU seems to be up to the territorial waters limit. So possibly the worst case scenario for Nord Stream 2 promoters is to have to build an offshore pipeline up to that point. But for the rest of it, it seems that it's an import pipeline whereby the third energy package does not apply. In other words, and from a regulatory perspective, Nord Stream 2 may delay, but if bankable, it will be built. Which brings us to the next part of this presentation. What about connecting pipelines? What you see here is an example of how Nord Stream 2 gas may need to be transported from the Baltic Sea to the German-Czech borders. It could be either through an expansion of existing pipelines, on your left, I guess, yes, on your left, or through the construction of new pipelines. In this case, it would be possibly EU Galen-Baci. But in particular, when a company from a third country active in the production or supply of gas is part of the pipeline deal, then the security of supply test kicks in. And we see that in Article 36 exemption decisions. The investment must enhance security of supply, the article reads. We also see that under Article 11, the NRA shall refuse to certify the TSO if it has not been demonstrated that granting certification will not put at risk the security of supply of both the member state and the EU. In fact, if you look at the recitals of the gas directive, you will realize First, with regard to the exemption decision, that's exactly for security of supply reasons that exemptions should be granted, in particular to connecting pipelines. Also, for certification purposes, a security of supply assessment seems to include basically three things: the independence of the network operation, the level of dependence on energy supply from third countries, and the level of trade with a particular third country. In essence, the security of supply translates in two things: diversification of sources, suppliers, and routes, and flexibility of the system. But how all these have been applied by the European Commission in practice? The first case is the OPAL pipeline. This is the connecting pipeline of Nord Stream 1, going through Germany to the Czech Republic, as you see. This is a partially exempted pipeline. Only 50% of its capacity can be used by its sponsors. The reasoning of the European Commission in this exemption decision, but that was back in 2009, was quite straightforward. OPAL is the connecting pipeline of Nord Stream 1. Nord Stream 1 is in the European interest, back in those days, and provides a completely new supply route to the EU without going through third countries. The existing pipelines are not enough to accommodate these volumes of gas, and also by connecting the Czech Republic, OPAL contributes to strengthening of the internal gas market and adds flexibility to help cope with the supply disruption. So the European Commission agreed at that point with the German NRA that OPAL will enhance, actually, security of supply. The 50% cap was due to competition concerns. 4 years later, in 2013, TAP was granted an exemption under Article 36 of the Gas Directive. TAP is a 10 BCM expandable pipeline connecting TANAP of Turkey to the Italian system. It will be, of course, connected with the Greek and the Albanian system for both firm and reverse flow. In this case, the reasoning of the European Commission focuses on the diversification of sources instead of routes, as in OPAL, and again on the flexibility of the systems because of the new interconnection. For the EU as a whole also, the EC reiterated expressly that the project is responding directly to the security of supply objective of diversification. I have also prepared a slide about Greece in the case of TAP. Without spending too much time on it, you may see that the European Commission emphasized exactly that. More gas is to arrive from the Caspian region, and because of the interconnections with both Italy and Albania, more flexibility will be added to the Greek system. The next case is, of course, very well known and concerns the certification of DESFA under SOCAR. When the European Commission gave its opinion on RISE preliminary certification decision, and that was the first ever certification decision under Article 11 of the Gas Directive, the relevant criteria were formulated. What mattered in that case was the following. DESFA was seen as a crucial entry gate of gas from multiple sources. SOCAR was also considered an important player. SOCAR would gain the sole control of DESFA. To that, you should add a fourth factor, although it was not expressly mentioned there, which is the conditions of the trading relationships. Okay, so in the case of DESFA, the European Commission thought that not all risks of undue third country influence were neutralized, and based on that, the Greek legislator introduced a new legal provision to the Greek energy law that allows for the suspension of voting rights under certain circumstances. Which brings us to the last case, the one where finally the so-called Gazprom clause was applied on Gazprom itself. Or sort of. This is the Yamal Europe pipeline. From Russia to Germany through Belarus and Poland. The case concerns the Polish part of the pipeline, co-owned by Gazprom and the Polish gas incumbent, but operated under the ISO unbundling model by the Polish TSO gas system. In TAP, top is an ITO. This was an ISO for those who are concerned about the unbundling models. The European Commission had paved the way for this case. And that's more than clear, because the practice followed in DESFA was totally confirmed here. You see, again, key infrastructure, key supplier, nature of control. The European Commission avoided to comment on the trade relations for obvious reasons. This is 2015 we're talking about. But it seems that when it does that, for the European Commission, not all risks are excluded and additional remedies may be necessary. It is noteworthy that the police NRA, or the police authorities in general, but the NRA was who took the final decision, denied such a risk to exist. So contrary to the Greek case, the police went ahead and they disregarded what the European Commission said. Okay, so Lee, maybe next time you ask my you invite us, I'll explain what happens then, right? Okay, but that was just the difference between these two cases. So before I close this presentation, I propose the following takeaway points. Nord Stream 2 most likely doesn't fall under the third energy package, contrary to connecting pipelines, which most certainly do. The security of supply is basically two things, diversification and flexibility. But the criteria for the supply, the security of supply impact assessment remain vague, leaving significant discretion on the part of the NRA for Article 11 certification cases and or the European Commission for Article 36 exemption decision. I have to say that in Article 36 exemption decision, the European Commission has takes a decision that the NRA has to follow, whereas in the Article 11 certification decision, cases, the European Commission just gives an opinion to the NRA. So, with this in mind, I'm sure that the politicization of EU energy legislation is not needed. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Paidakakis, for this rich, very high informative presentation. Are there any questions on this presentation, please? Yes, please.
It's really just a clarification. You said at the very end, George, that politicization is not needed. But that's because it's there, right? That was what you were saying, I think.
You know better than me that this is highly political issues and cases, and it was just a provocative last word. But it's politicized from both parts. It's politicized from those who don't want the third energy package to apply on Nord Stream and the opposite.
Any other questions? No more questions. So we go on with two more presentations. The first one will be by Mr. John Apsouris. The second one, excuse me for that. The first one of Mrs. Alexia Trokoudi, Senior Legal Counsel on Energy Hellenic Petroleum. She has practiced as legal counsel in Attica Bank and OTE. She has provided her legal services for 12 years in RAE, and of course she is a member of Hellenic Organization for Energy Law. You have the floor.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank FSR and also Mr. Antonis Metaxas that gave us the kind opportunity to participate into such an interesting event and for giving us the opportunity to present the proposal for the amendment of the regulation 994 of 2010 for the gas security of supply and the importance of the European legal framework on intergovernmental agreements with third countries as a means of safeguarding security of supply in the Union. I will describe the current provisions of the regulation, the proposal for its amendment, and then Mr. Apsouris will present the relevant delegation on the amendment of the current legislative framework on the IGAs. Regulation 994 of 2010 was adopted following the 2009 gas crisis and set measures to safeguard security of natural gas supply. It set measures according to which natural gas undertakings based on market mechanisms are primarily responsible to ensure gas supplies and in case such mechanisms fail, then the member states kick in measures to ensure gas availability to protected customers. The regulation introduced some basic principles. The concept of protected customers includes those whose gas supplies must be guaranteed, including all households, the district heating installation if fuel switching is not possible, and some other categories that the member state may decide that they are kind of they have a kind of sensitive character, and it is on the member state to decide which category. The regulation gave the opportunity to the member states to establish such categories of sensitive categories. The regulation set also the supply standard, which requires that the NRAs must guarantee that the gas undertakings are able to deliver gas either for a 7-day peak temperature or at least for 30 days of exceptional high demand, or for at least 30 days when the single infrastructure, large infrastructure, does not work. In order to safeguard the security of supply in case of a disruption, the regulation stipulates that there must be permanent bidirectional capacity with physical reverse flows, and any exemptions from this requirement must be granted by the NRAs on a detailed cost-based analysis, which must have also the approval of the Commission. The member states must submit, under the counter regulation, the member states must submit a risk assessment, a prevention action plan, and an emergency plan. These plans must be exchanged and consulted between the member states to ensure that the national measures are not inconsistent with each other. The final plans must also be published. The national plans must be updated every 2 years and submitted to the gas coordination group. Still, it must be noted, and that's important, that under the current regulation, the neighboring member states are not obliged to assess a regional plan. Further, the regulation stipulates 3 crisis levels: the early warning, the alert, and the emergency level, and specifies the role of the Commission and the Member States in case of the declaration of an EU or a regional emergency. The Commission has simply a coordinating role, mainly through safeguarding transparency and exchange of information, it must be noted that under the current regulation, the regulation, does not provide the Commission with direct powers to order member states to take particular decisions in case of a union or a regional emergency. Finally, the regulation stipulates that until the 3rd of December of 2011, the member states must notify to the Commission any already existing gas supply contract of duration of more than 1 year or any existing intergovernmental agreements between member states with third countries. But this politically very sensitive issue of IGAs will be examined in detail later on by Mr. Apsouris during the second part of this presentation. Following a stress test, the Commission published a report about the implementation of the Regulation 994. As far as the definition of the protected customers, the report speaks about large discrepancies between the member states during the implementation of the definition. Further, according to the preventive plans submitted to the Commission, it became clear that the member state had a difficulty to interpret the supply standard concept. Generally, the Commission's reports speaks about a lack of information from the member states as far as the capacity volumes for the protected customers, as far as they're concerned. The regulation imposed on the member states to enable by the 3rd of December of 2014 permanent bidirectional capacity on all relevant cross-border points. The share of bidirectional cross-border interconnection points within the EU has increased from 24% in 2009 to 40% by 2014. Four more border interconnections have already been we're speaking about Germany with Denmark, Italy with Austria, Greece with Bulgaria, and Romania with Hungary. Still, the assessment carries out that so far the regulation has focused too much on the direct benefits for the neighbor only. And therefore, it is recommended that in the future, more attention should be made to possible beneficial effects for security of supply along the whole transportation corridor. In February of 2016, the Commission proposed a new security of supply regulation. The proposal retains the existing, as said above, definition of protected customer and supply standard, but further on, sets some other measures, which are: it introduces the solidarity principle as a last resort, according to which, in severe crisis, the neighbor members will safeguard the gas supply to the households and essential social services like healthcare or other security services. The proposal introduces a regional approach instead of a national approach when the member state design their security of supply measures. Thus, the member states prepare every 4 years their risk assessments, preventive action plans, and emergency plans under specific templates that are in an annex into the proposal. Furthermore, new non-market-based measures to comply with the supply standard would become subject to an impact assessment, and they would be notified to the Commission regarding the proportionality and the general impact to the internal market and the security of supply in other member states. The Commission may ask for an amendment in case if the Commission is of the opinion that these measures may have negative effect on internal market, on the security of another member state. The proposal introduces also mandatory regional prevention, action, and emergency plans through specific templates annexed to the proposal, and they must be reassessed every 4 years. The regional plans will pass through a process of a peer review organized by the Commission. When measures could have a negative impact on the security of supply of another member state or region, or hamper the functioning of the EU internal market, the Commission has the right to ask the member states to amend the plans accordingly, first on an opinion, and in case the member states do not comply to that, via a legally binding decision. To that end, the Commission has proposed a list of 7 regions that is included in an annex into the proposal, taking into account geographical proximity, any common supply lines, and also any existing interconnections. The rule of N1, everyone common to us, the infrastructure standard, remains the same, but it must take into account the national hydraulic calculations and EU stress tests with the cooperation of the Commission and the ENTSO-G. Member states cannot anymore, according to the proposal, of course, take any decision unilaterally. But they must jointly decide on the construction of bidirectional capacity at each cross-border interconnection. Under the proposal, the case of the exception from this rule is not easy anymore. The joint decisions of the member states for the exemption, I'm talking about the exemptions, the joint decisions of the member states are forwarded to ACER, then ACER forwards its opinion to the Commission for the final decision. Any exemption can be granted only for a period of 4 years, and then after the expiration of this period, the same procedure must apply again. The proposal reinforces the cooperation of the member states with the energy community contracting parties and imposes the obligation of a joint act of the EU member states and the energy community. To that end, of course, reciprocal obligation will apply. Finally, the proposal proposes additional transparency, obliging the gas companies to inform automatically the Commission upon the conclusion or any kind of modification of gas supply contract for a period longer than 1 year in case the volumes of the contract accounts for more of 40% of the natural gas consumption of the member state. The Commission may request the amendment of the plans on the basis of the notified contracts. According to the provisions of Protocol 2 of the Lisbon Treaty, during last April, few reasoned opinions were submitted to the European Council from some member states, of course. Their main consideration was that the power of the Commission to set alone specific regions without any prior consultation and approval from the member states concerned is not incompatible with the EU legislation. According to the opinions, this stipulation violates the legislation of the exercise of the delegation, and due to that, the proposal does not fulfill the principle of subsidiarity. These opinions also stated that the determination of the region should be made under further specific criteria related to the provisions of relevant regulation like 715 of 2009 and 347 of 2013. Some opinion states that the big amount of information asked by the Commission causes administrative and financial burden and that obligation goes beyond the scope of the proposal. Also, they said that the obligation to set up new infrastructure goes also beyond the scope of the proposal, and due to that, it violates the principle of proportionality. The Commission replied to the above-mentioned reasoned opinions, pointing out mainly the following. The lack of information about the capacity volumes of the protected customers and the necessity for a regional approach of the security of gas supply was clearly indicated into the Commission's assessment, and to that end, the proposal sets an obligation for regional risk amendments and plans. In order to enhance the security, the proposal sets regional groups. The region, according to the Commission, the regions of the regulation for the trans-European energy infrastructure cannot be used, as the objective of this regulation is a different one in comparison with the regulation of the security of supply. The Commission is of the opinion that the exercise of delegation is not violated, since the Member States are actively involved through the legislative process of the discussions into the Energy Working Party in the Council. Besides, according to the proposal, these regions may be amended if such a need arises. Finally, the Commission states that the security of supply in the Union is enhanced by the obligation for the cooperation in through the cooperation with the energy community. The debate, the first debate for the proposal has already begun in 6th and 7th of June of April of this year, and it's going on. And we're all waiting for the next steps and the new findings. Now I'm going to give the floor to Mr. Absouris for the second part of the presentation. Thank you very much.
You give the floor, okay. Thank you very much in any case for the excellent presentation. And I would like to introduce the second speaker, Mr. Absouris, who is the General Counsel of ELPE, a very well-known lawyer, who has published studies and articles in Greek and international legal issues, not only on energy law.
Thank you very much, Professor Kaissis. I would like to thank the Florence School of Regulation, the Hellenic Energy Regulation Institute, and Professor Metaxas in particular for the opportunity that they gave me to address such a distinguished public and such distinguished guests. So, ladies and gentlemen.
Mr. Apsouris, allow me a short interruption. Who will put the questions after the end of the second presentation?
Yeah, they're joint anyway. Thank you. Now, one of the most contentious elements in EU energy policies, no doubt, the IGAs, the bilateral agreements that member states sign with third energy exporting countries. The energy union strategy indicates that an important element in ensuring energy security is full compliance of agreements related to the buying of energy from third countries with EU law. In the same spirit, the European Council, in its conclusions of March 19, 2015, also called for full compliance with EU law of all agreements related to the buying of gas from external suppliers, notably by reinforcing transparency of such agreements and compatibility with EU energy security provisions. Now, at the same time, EU energy dependency from third countries is increasing. According to Eurostat, in less than 25 years, from 1990 until 2013, the share of net imports of energy products in the EU has increased from 45% to 55% of gross inland energy consumption. And with the depletion of traditional indigenous sources, this share is bound to rise further. So member states are constantly seeking new energy supplies outside the EU, and the negotiations with third parties very often take political dimensions that take the form of intergovernmental agreements or IGAs, as they're very well known. So those agreements are executed between one or more member states and such third countries. Now, I believe that it is obvious, it's apparent that those IGAs are key instruments in ensuring compliance of the agreements with third parties with EU law. However, compliance of some provisions of EU internal energy market legislation and competition law is not always in the commercial interest of third country energy suppliers. Therefore, member states can be forced sometimes to include regulatory concessions in their IGAs with third countries, and such concessions may threaten the smooth operation and proper functioning of the EU internal market. In light of such challenge, the European Council adopted decision 994 of 2012, of October 25th, 2012, the famous IGA decision, addressing the above issue by setting up a mechanism for the exchange of information with regards to the IGAs with third parties in the field of energy. Now, the IGA decision defines those agreements as legally binding agreements between one or more member states and one or more third countries having an impact on the operation or the functioning of the internal energy market or on the security of supply in the Union. And in this respect, the IGA decision applies to all energy commodity-related supplies and infrastructure IGAs, in particular gas, oil, and electricity. Only the IGAs concerning matters within falling within the spectrum of the Euratom Treaty are not covered. Thus, it is fair to assess that the IGA decision, although closely linked to the Regulation 994 of 2010, to which Mrs. Tropoudi referred earlier, the scope of the information exchange mechanism it establishes is wider. On the other hand, the scope of the IGA decision excludes commercial contracts between commercial entities, while the impact assessment developed for the review of Regulation 994 of 2010 addresses the specific issue, as Mrs. Tropoudi said earlier. So in my view, the two regulatory texts are complementary. As a general rule, IGAs are governed by international law, by public international law, and especially by the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties of May 23rd, 1969. Greece, as you well know, has ratified this convention in 1974 by virtue of legislative decree 402 of 1974. IGAs usually fall into one or more of the following three categories. Now, either there are IGAs providing the framework for the construction of import and export infrastructure, most notably cross-border oil, gas, and electricity infrastructure. There are IGAs relating to the purchase of commodities such as oil or gas. And third, there are IGAs of a more general nature establishing a framework for bilateral energy cooperation between member states and third parties. Now, after May 2014, the Commission initiated a process to assess the application of the IGA decision that resulted in a proposal on February 16, 2016 for the revision of such decision. Now, the assessment focused mainly on three axes. First, the extent to which the IGA decision promoted compliance with EU law and promoted a high level of coordination between member states with regard to the IGAs. Second, the impact of the IGA decision on the negotiations of member states with third countries. And third, the extent to which the scope of the IGA decision and the procedures provided by it are appropriate. The main reasons for which such a revision process was initiated during 2014 are, in my view, two. The first is geopolitical. It has to do with a dramatic change in the geopolitical context since 2012, when the current IGA decision was adopted. We have the Ukrainian crisis and the political instability in regions that are crucial also for external energy relations, such as the Middle East and Northern Africa. Now, those changes have put security of energy supply at the top of political agenda. Moreover, the South Stream debacle has illustrated the need for ensuring more legal certainty for large infrastructure investments. Now, South Stream, as you may probably remember, was a gas pipeline project planned to run from Russia via the Black Sea to Bulgaria, Serbia, Hungary, and onwards to Austria and potentially Italy. Now, the initial supplies were planned to take place in the fall of 2015. Russia signed six IGAs with member states and two other IGAs with non-member states. Well, finally, on December 1st, 2014, Russian President Putin announced in a press conference that South Stream would be discontinued. Now, the Commission expressed concerns the fact it was able to address the non-compatibility of the South Stream-related IGAs only ex post created a complex and difficult legal, political, and economic situation for the parties involved. Now, the second reason for the commencement of the revision of the IGA decision in 2014 has to do with the increased awareness of the Commission and the Member States on the negative effect of incompatible IGAs on the internal energy market and on the size of the problem after the establishment of the information exchange system in 2012. Now, within the frame of the evaluation of the IGA decision, 124 IGAs were notified by Member States to the Commission following the adoption of the IGA decision. Now, some of them, after analyzing those IGAs, the Commission has expressed doubts on the compatibility with EU law of 17 IGAs, which were important, though. So even if the majority of the notified IGAs were in line with EU law, around one-third of the most relevant IGAs, meaning those related to energy infrastructures or the supply of energy commodities, contain provisions that were not compliant with EU law. In addition, some of these non-compliant IGAs resulted in very complex legal situation with member states. Another important conclusion of the Commission's impact assessment is that after signature of an IGA, changes are very difficult for political and legal reasons alike. On the one hand, once an IGA is executed, there is an important political incentive for member states to avoid tensions with their contractual counterparty. And on the other hand, apart from the political considerations that Mr. Paidakakis wishes to avoid, there are there is a complex legal situation that member states face only face once they have signed an IGA with a third country. Now, from the public international law perspective, member states are obliged to comply with the obligations set out in the agreement that they have signed. The fact that an IGA is not compliant with EU law does not in principle release the member states from the need to comply with these obligations, since the third country is not a member of the EU and therefore not obliged to comply with EU law. From the EU law perspective, member states are obliged to fulfill their obligations under EU law. The fact that third country is not bound by EU law is of no relevance. Member states must take all appropriate steps to eliminate the incompatibilities between EU law and the IGA in question. This means that the member state must renegotiate or terminate the IGA where appropriate or face sanctions by the EU. It has to be noted, though, that so far the Commission has not launched any infringement procedure against member states for having executed IGAs that are not non-compliant with EU law. Now, for the termination or renegotiation of IGAs, the rules under public international law apply. Termination or renegotiation are, first of all, possible, and to the extent that they are provided in the IGA itself. In some specific cases, member states may also have recourse to the termination and adaptation grounds set out in the Vienna Convention. Now, on the basis of the provisions described above, member states have not generally been in a position to unilaterally terminate or amend their IGAs and have only been able to object to their automatic renewal. So, based on the above assessment, the Commission came down to the conclusion that the IGA decision in its present form is not considered effective, since it has not directly impacted member states' negotiations with third parties, nor it has resulted in the transformation of concluded non-compliant IGAs into compliant ones. In light of such a conclusion, the Commission proposed the amendment of the IGA decision. A number of options for that amendment have been examined. The first one is the baseline, do nothing. The second, establish model clauses for inclusion in IGAs which do not infringe EU law. The option three has to do with the ex-ante assessment of the IGAs by the Commission, which is obligatory for member states. The option four has to do with the Commission's right to participate as an observer in IGA negotiations. And the fifth option is the negotiation by the Commission itself of EU agreements in the field of energy. After assessing the above five options, the Commission came down to the conclusion that option three, that means the ex-ante assessment, is the most effective and appropriate choice, either alone or in combination with option two, having to do with optional model clauses. The main differences of the Commission's proposal for the revision of the IGA decision from the existing decision are the following. The first is, of course, the ex-ante assessment, which is obligatory for the member states. The second is that agreements between undertakings are not covered by notification obligations, but may be submitted on a voluntary basis. The third is the obligation of the member states to submit to the Commission existing and future non-binding instruments with all accompanying documents, and the Commission may perform an ex-post assessment of such non-binding instruments. The fourth is the obligation of the Commission to share documents it has received with other member states, which is subject to confidentiality provisions. Now, how do member states react to the Commission's proposal? Now, they have all agreed, all member states that participated in the consultation that lasted from July 28th to October 22nd of 2015, they have all agreed that the energy union has to be fully supported. They have established their belief that energy security needs a European perspective and increased regional cooperation that has to lead to more solidarity and trust between the member states. So no one dissented in that full compliance with EU law of all agreements is imperative. Yet their reaction to the content of the Commission's proposal for the revision of the IGA's decision is extremely divided. Half of such member states, mainly Eastern European ones, with Poland as standard bearer, maintain that the ex-ante assessment of IGA's by the Commission should also extend to commercial contracts and include not mere compatibility with EU law, but also the overall impact of such contracts on EU energy security. The other half of the member states that participated in the consultation, mainly Western European states, among which Germany and France, but also Hungary and the Czech Republic, expressed the view that the current information mechanism with regard to the IGAs is quite balanced in terms of transparency and effectiveness and does not need any further improvements. Now, those member states maintained that to establish an obligatory involvement of the Commission in the way of an ex-ante verification mechanism would be a grave reduction of the member state's sovereignty, and that the comparison made by the Commission with the ex-ante verification mechanism of Article 103 of the Euratom Treaty is not convincing, since the treaty is a specific instrument of international law proper to nuclear energy and its peculiarities. Finally, those member states expressed concerns about the Commission's proposal, and they have viewed that with regard to existing IGAs that violate EU law, the Commission has already the necessary tool at hand. It can start an infringement procedure against the relevant member state, yet it has not done so. All undertakings and business federations from the energy industry that participated in the consultation expressed the view that the current IGA decision is adequate and effective and does not need to be changed. That is not the first manifestation of the division in the opinions of the member states with respect to the involvement of the Commission in the negotiation and drafting of the IGAs. The same debate between solidarity on one hand and national sovereignty on the other was apparent in the public consultation of the IGA decision in 2011 and the procedure for its adoption by the EU Council and Parliament in 2012. In fact, the IGA decision is considered as a fruit of a fine compromise between the two sides. Now, what are my views on this? In my view, there's little doubt that the ex-post assessment of the IGAs by the Commission has limitations in its effectiveness. An ex-ante assessment would increase legal certainty, which in its turn will enhance investment initiatives. However, such ex-ante intervention of the Commission has to be expedient. The 6 and 12 weeks response deadlines provided by the Commission's proposal are extremely long, in my view, and have to be drastically reduced at most to 2 or 3 weeks, respectively. More attention has to be paid to confidentiality, also prerogatives that have to be respected with regard to sharing data with other members. Finally, I'm of the opinion that the even ex-post assessment by the Commission of legally non-binding instruments, such as MOUs, statements, etc., is a grave intervention of the Commission in the member states' right to determine their national foreign policy vis-à-vis third countries. In that respect, such intervention is an attack to the core of the notion of national sovereignty and as such should be avoided. The fact that commercial agreements between undertakings still fall outside the scope of the IGA decision is, in my view, positive. I believe that, as in 2012, the Commission will not have an easy time before the EU Council and Parliament in getting through its proposal for the amendment of the IGA decision. Even in light of the recent AFED decision, the ITRE opinion of May 30th, and the draft opinion of the Committee on International Trade that has been discussed last Monday, I believe that it will not be easy. Now, enthusiasts of closing the ranks in the energy union need not despair. As resulted from the South Stream traumatic experience, but also from the DESFA experience, EU competition provisions are a useful and effective tool for ensuring that the member states and third countries alike abide by the EU acquis. The provisions of Regulation 994 of 2010 also are of additional help and importance, as aforementioned by Mr. Okoudi. Finally, I believe perhaps that it is high time that EU strikes with important energy exporting third countries, such as the Russian Federation or Azerbaijan, bilateral agreements that will enhance compliance with EU law of bilateral agreements between individual member states and such third countries, and also commercial agreements between private undertakings. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Absouris, for this excellent presentation. I would like to open the floor for questions on both. You have a comment, yes, please. You have.
Since there are no questions, I just wanted to share with you my experience with the IGAs, especially since I saw the last point of Mr. Absouris with regard to an IGA with Russia and Azerbaijan. With Russia, I can hardly see how this can happen. It's almost impossible right now. With Azerbaijan, during the certification decision of VESPA, the Commission asked about or pressed for an IGA between the European Union and Azerbaijan to be a prerequisite, an IGA between these two parties to be a prerequisite for us to certify VESPA and the SOCAR, which was clearly not the case, and the Council at the end didn't allow it based on the legal service as well. So that is one point and concerns the IGA as a prerequisite. Then it's also, I guess, interesting to know that the Nord Stream 1, which was, you know, Nord Stream and South Stream was the basic strategy tools of Gazprom. The Nord Stream 1, there is no IGA there. No IGA. And the European Commission tolerated that, in general, tolerated. South Stream, it's a different story. They tried to do an IGA, and they found themselves, the Bulgarian partners, found themselves having to terminate the progress of the project. And then, with regard to Nord Stream 2, and from what I've heard about Germany, that it says it's the present situation is quite balanced, this should not come as a surprise to anybody, especially if what comes to my mind is what the coalition partner of Mrs. Merkel said, that they want to keep it within their administration. They want to keep, Germany wants to keep the decision within Germany. That means they don't want to mess with the European Commission. So it should come as no surprise that Germany doesn't want, you know, any more involvement of the European Commission when it comes to issues like that. Okay, and of course, should Nord Stream 2 happens, Germany would become the biggest hub of gas in Europe. Thank you.
Thank you, George, for the comments. I just want to say a couple of things. First, the last remark had to do with an IGA not between any individual member state and the Russian Federation or Azerbaijan, but between the EU and the Russian Federation and potentially Azerbaijan. It will be difficult, it may be difficult, but I believe that it's the only way to resolve any problems for the future. But this is a personal opinion, obviously. Now, with respect to the IGA having to do with DESFA, at that time I was very skeptical about it, but now, many years afterwards, more than 3 years down the road and where we are right now, I believe that perhaps it could have been a good solution to the progress of this project. Thank you.
Any other questions? Well, allow me to put a question, please. After all, suppose we have a gas supply crisis in Europe. The question which arises is, who will do what in Europe and in Greece?
According to the new proposal, the Commission has a major role, and then it has, according to the proposal, it has the power to give specific directions to the member states prior of prior cooperation of the gas coordination group and SOG, and the commission may take specific decisions according to how this problem, the any emergency plan, emergency case shall apply. The Commission shall have the opportunity to impose specific obligations. This is the major difference through what we have now with the specific regulation 9 and 4 and the coming one. The Commission up to now had a just coordinating rule through, as I said, existing information passing through the member states and the NRAs and the undertakings, the information needed. But now it has the power to take specific roles, specific decisions. This is a major change.
Very important change, and we speak about supply crisis. It means we need something which happen very quick and immediately, and we must see how efficient this solution could be. This is a problem. And the second one, which I would like to ask you maybe, we have now the Commission proposal, and this has, according to my opinion, at least an impact not only to the European countries, but to all countries which are connected to this.
Contracted
to this. How will be that managed? Legally, I mean.
Your question is. I can understand your question. The regulation stipulates that there must be specific procedures for these situations. Meaning what? That in case of such emergencies, the EU member state must come in compliant, must cooperate with the energy contracting parties, which means that the energy community parties must have adopted the EU acquis. And to that end, and due to that I had just 10 minutes to present the whole presentation, I didn't have the opportunity to present the whole. You're absolutely right. This is a very difficult issue because the proposal for the amendment of the regulation provides that there must be a peer review from the Commission. According with the EU energy party contracting parties, that there must be a specific decision that will take reciprocal obligations between each other. Of course, the requirement is that the energy community parties have decided to apply the EU acquis.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Trokoudi. Any questions? It looks... Please. Oh, yes. Now we have one.
Apart, not that Germany is not a member of the European Union with equal obligations as any other member, but I consider that if we want to build an integrated EU gas market, then by entering into independently negotiated IGAs, as has happened in the past with South Stream. For example, the contract, the agreement the Bulgarians had negotiated contravened a number of provisions of the EU acquis. Does not help in building an internal integrated gas market. And as the European Union is the guardian of the treaties itself, then all member states have to accept some form of EU Commission supervision. Now, unfortunately, it seems that we have arrived in a period where, on a number of issues, several member states want to follow their own road. But then we should not speak about integrating our markets. And the other issue is, especially versus Russia, do we believe that we have more power to negotiate with Russia gas supplies compared to the weight of the European Union negotiating as a whole? And at the very end, Russia depends on Europe for gas because it's here where they get the good prices. They will not get them neither from China nor from anywhere else in Asia or from any of their other clients.
Thank you. This was a comment and a question too. And I think this was in line with the position of Mr. Apsouris. Would you like to...
Yeah, exactly. This was exactly my position.
Okay. So we come to the end of this session. Our last speaker is Mr. Kyriakos Papanikolaou, professor of public law at the Law School of Democritus University and author of many books and articles about energy law. He is very experienced in energy law as a practicing lawyer, and I have the feeling that we met each other in the ICC in an energy case, but hopefully. You have the floor, and please.
Thank you, Professor Kaissis. I would like to express my special thanks to the hosts of this conference, the FSR and the Hellenic Institute of Regulation, of Energy Regulation. My special thanks to Professor Metaxas, who made this kind invitation to participate in this session. I would like to talk about some implications, some political implications that come out of the Nord Stream 2 case. I think that the Nord Stream 2 case provides us with an opportunity to consider the political background of some legal provisions on the energy sector and especially the gas sector. My presentation will not be technical. The previous speakers presented some highly technical and excellent presentations on issues concerning as well the Nord Stream 2 issues. Mr. Paidakakis especially has already done that. So I will try to speak and highlight these political implications using a common vocabulary in European and constitutional law. I will talk about precedence, about competence. I will talk about extraterritoriality in the application of law in order to highlight the political value of the legal arguments expressed in this case. The issue of the European Union law application in the field of energy infrastructure brings us in front of a perception of European Union different from the usual one. Almost always we see European Union through the lens of integration, and that means that it is a reality and a project which is bigger than its member states. This is a bottom-up perspective. European Union law gives the rule, and its parts must conform to this order. On the other hand, international law scholars see European Union as a regional entity on the international ground. In that case, European Union is part of a top-down design of the global reality. I think that the case of energy infrastructure, especially pipeline networks, provides us with a hybrid perspective. European Union law claims authority. That is a bottom-up perspective, again, in relation to pipelines. But this authority is not restricted to its natural field of application. The hybrid element of the view is that it is only in part vertical and at the same time partly horizontal. This means that European Union law claims precedence, that is a vertical dimension, but not in a bottom-up direction, which means not over its own parts. On the contrary, this authority is claimed by a regional factor at the international level over other regions which are involved in the construction and operation of pipelines, and this is obviously a horizontal dimension. Of course, such hybrid view is not a peculiarity of the pipeline sector, but it is well established in other EU law sectors as well. The most prominent example, of course, is the competition sector, where European Union claims application of its law over economic entities and practices outside its territorial scope, which have an effect on interstate trade. Such examples raise the very important question of extraterritorial application of European Union law. Extraterritoriality is, of course, a very intriguing issue of even broader scope in the era of globalization. And of course, it is not a problem primarily of the European Union, but even before that, it is a problem about the borders of state authority. The transnational administrative acts, for example, provide us with an excellent occasion and an excellent instance of extraterritoriality. But let me come back to pipelines. In this case, the case of pipelines, we have the most material instance of extraterritoriality. We don't have, as it is in the competition cases, competition law cases, an effect coming into the European Union territory through agreements or other practices performed in another land. We don't have either an administrative act of a non-European Union member state which is equipped with legal validity through rules or agreements. In the case of pipelines, European Union claims authority over entities incorporated into land or immersed in the sea. A part of these energy routes lies in the European Union territory, and another part lies out of it. However, a pipeline, as always stressed by Mr. Paidakakis previously, a pipeline cannot be functional in parts, but only as a whole, as a main or secondary network. This transnationality of hard territorial substance requires one law to be applied. If the legal orders of the regional entities involved, such as the European Union and Russia, cannot converge, then a game of precedence is to be played. And if both players claim competence, then it is no more a matter of law, but rather a matter of politics. That's why in the case of Nord Stream 2, the general feeling was that politics have overcome law. This comment has not to do with any subsumption to the political game of the legal opinions expressed by the competent European authorities and agencies, of course. I'm talking neither about the validity of the legal arguments. They have been adequately presented and commented. I just want to point out by this comment that by its nature, the construction and operation of transnational pipelines is a matter of hard political substance because of two elements: the strictly material quality of such projects and their networking structure. The practical problem is that the extraterritoriality view is deeply monistic, but in a pluralistic world and multiple regional competence, but in a pluralistic world of multiple regional competence, law cannot easily stand on the surface of the relevant discussion, and therefore, naturally, it is used more as an argument in the political terrain. Part of this view of final European Union control over pipelines is the recent proposal for the new decision on the information exchange mechanism, about which Mr. Apsouris just talked to us. A mechanism of soft ex-post checks, which exists, is to be transformed in an ex-ante assessment of intergovernmental agreements. I think that all this political background is reflected into the Nord Stream 2 case, already mentioned as well. The principal argument against Nord Stream 2, thank you, was that since that pipeline comes through territories of member states, which means through European Union territory, it must fully comply with European Union law, especially with the third energy package on ownership unbundling, third-party access, and so on. European Union law is to be fully applied so far as the project runs under European Union territorial jurisdiction. But it is practically impossible for European Union law to be applied only at the European part of the project, as already said, because this is an object of European Union law jurisdiction which is strictly material and with a networking structure. For this reason, it cannot work in double or partial terms. So the legal objection already expressed would affect the whole project if it was accepted by the stakeholders. Mr. Paidakakis mentioned it as well previously. Of course, the application of the energy package on supply security, diversification of sources, and so on is the most formidable barrier to the construction and operation of this project. However, it should not be overlooked that if European Union law is to be applied, then it should be applied as a whole, which means that all rules on public procurement and on the terms of environmental protection should be applied. For example, Directive number 30 of 2013 on safety of offshore oil and gas operations should be applied. As it is known, this directive is an achievement of European Union law which was pending for many years because of resistance to its adoption. It is conforming to prior international standards on offshore protection through licensing and prevention policies. It also promotes transparency of the decision making and public accountability. Moreover, Directive 25 of the year 2014 applies to the procurement in the energy sector as well. Extraction of gas falls within the scope of this directive, whereas exploration is excluded. By the term extraction, it is meant production of gas, according to the preamble, and in turn, production should be considered to include development, that is, the setting up of adequate infrastructure, such as pipelines for future production of gas. Now, to come back to the Nord Stream 2 case. This holistic approach of EU law application is reflected to the most recent official views of the Commission. An example, on July 15, Commission answered a parliamentary question on Nord Stream 2 in the following words. And I will read it because I think that it is important for the whole spirit behind the case. Nord Stream 2, if constructed, and as any other pipeline in the European Union, will have to comply fully with applicable EC law, including energy, competition, public procurement, and environmental rules. The construction of an infrastructure project such as Nord Stream 2 cannot happen in a legal void. This would also run counter to the interest of economic operators in having legal certainty. Neither can it be exclusively operated only according to Russian law. Against the background of colliding legal regimes, a legal framework would be needed that takes account of the key principles of EU energy market rules. The Commission is in contact with the German government on this issue. The collision of jurisdictions is absolute in this case, and it seems there is no way out. Law becomes again a political argument, and the game of prevalence goes on. I think that the challenges in this hot energy sector will be insistent, and therefore some compromise should be sought. Of course, currently we come through a difficult period of tension in the political arena of external relations of the Union, especially with Russia. But still, since the negotiations on principles of regulation in this sector will not be one-day case, this field must be constantly and independently open to discussion. Otherwise, the external tensions might anytime be transformed into internal pressure to the Union, since member states participating in such projects will potentially have interests contrary to the application of some European Union rules. If such a line of thought prevails, then the legal way to adequately deal with a problem of compromise, we are talking about a compromise between normativity and political realism in this case. So the instrument will be obvious. International agreements of the Union with third countries for an ad hoc approach in terms of the special characteristics of each case. In this way, Union will be able to preserve in an inductive way the primary law premises and the acquis through a principled and constant discussion at the political level, which discussion will hopefully be reflected into legal instruments. Such a coordination between the Union and member states at this international level is necessary for additional reasons. The field is covered mainly by IGAs, intergovernmental agreements, and host government agreements. Moreover, at some points, there is already a convergence between these instruments and there, among these instruments, and the formation of a public lex mercatoria is in progress even in this sector. So, it is well known, on the other hand, that in the national legal orders exist significant discrepancies to the systemic relationship as to the systemic relationships between national, international, and European law. For example, in relation to our Greek constitution for all our friends from abroad. Article 28 of the Greek Constitution provides that international agreements lie in a normative level between the Constitution and the other sources of law, statutes, and so on. It would be wise to prevent possible contradiction between international agreements and EU law at the national level. And I think that to this direction, this coordination between the European Union and the national level by the instrument of international agreements in this sector would be a proper cure. Let us not leave the space open to any other temptations of constitutional value. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this very interesting and very informative presentation. We came to the end of the first part of the conference, and I would like to thank all of you for your presentations, you for your comments, for your questions, and of course the interpreters too. And we have now 1 hour break, lunch break. No, 30 minutes. So I wish to everybody good bon appetit.